should be encouraging, although this fine hacker is currently in the lead, although it's a, you can see it's a pretty close race here. There's some stuff going on, so good jobs. Keep hacking. And let's keep going. Okay, so on Wednesday before spring break, we were talking about memory corruption vulnerabilities and specifically buffer overflows. So why are buffer overflows interesting? Got it.
Because we can create unintended side effects or intentional side effects.
Right? Ooh. So explain, so we can create intentional side effects, meaning what?
Override your EIP.
Right, so we can, essentially think of it by hijacking the control flow of the application, right? In a normal execution of a program, when you call a function, and that function returns, where do you go?
The previous
caller. Yeah, the person who called that function, right? The previous caller. But if we overwrite the same EIP on the stack, we can divert the control flow to something that we control. And by doing this very precisely, we can, control the code and essentially completely hijack the code that's actually executed. So this is kind of the general flavor of buffer overflow is that we can overwrite memory addresses. And so, but where are places, where can buffers be? Can they only be on the stack? What was that?
BSS section.
Yeah, it could be a global variable, which will be in the BSS section. So what could you maybe override with that? Are any EIPs stored in the global variables? Probably not. But what can you override?
Is the global offset table over there as well?
I don't know. That's a good question. Possibly. It depends on the exact memory layout.
Because if it was, you could overwrite a function call.
Right, so you can overwrite something in the global offset table, which would overwrite where that goes. You could overwrite other global variables, right, which could control the flow of the execution. Where else can buffers be? Can they live? So they could be passed into our program, so they could be on the environment, which could then maybe let us overwrite other environments, variables. Where else? On the heap. Could be on the heap, right? It could be a malloc data, and maybe by overwriting that. So the way to think about this, even though we focus on buffer overflows, because these are kind of the intro to memory corruption, but essentially we're able to modify memory in the application. So, and in the case of a buffer overflow, we're limited to overflowing contiguous memory from the beginning of that pointer in the buffer, and either usually over the buffer. But we can generalize this to different kinds of memory corruption. We'll look at another type of vulnerability where we can write whatever bytes we want wherever in the program. And that gives us a different level of control than buffer overflows, but still the same general idea. And so, you know, we can overwrite, if we're on the stack, we know we can overwrite the saved EIP. We can also overwrite the saved EBP, which is actually a pretty cool type of attack where we can then control where the stack is located and do other types of things. We can overwrite, we didn't talk about it, but we can overwrite pointers to functions. So in C, you can pass a pointer to a function into a function, and then you can jump and call that function. So if there's any function pointers, we can overwrite those and potentially divert the control flow. We can do all kinds of cool stuff. So you can even, you know, traditionally we think buffer overflow means you overflow the saved EIP and then get control flow. But really, you know, what if there's a variable on the stack that says if you're the admin or not, a 1 or a 0? So in this case, you don't even care about overflowing the EIP, you just want to be admin. So all you need to do is overflow by 1 and set that value to 1, and then now you're an admin. So as we'll see, there's all types of ways to cause overflows. We looked at copy functions. It could be custom variables with array indexing, integer overflows by forcing an integer, loops, and we talked about the different ways of what to overwrite. So this is kind of thinking of it in a very general way. So, so this is trying to generalize this concept and thinking about, well, if I want to just read a file, why not change the buffer of a file pointer that's being accessed to point to some file name that I want? So rather than necessarily, so let's say there's a value in the program that points to slash whatever, temp slash t dot txt, but it's a setuid program and we actually want to read or edit etc shadow. So if we can use our overflow to change that value, right, we can change bytes in the program, it will now open that new file. Yeah, so I already talked about these. Okay, so the important ones here, let's say, are, I think we'll go into this later, of changing the state base pointer, but when we talk about function pointers, so the global offset table is a very ripe area for overwriting if we can. So how does the global offset table work? Why does it exist? Back to like a month ago.
When a function is first called, it allows for dynamic calling of functions, right? Or,
why do you need to dynamically call a function?
To save, because you don't know where your logical memory might necessarily lay out. It saves space, right? That you can.
Kind of. Correct, but most, so when you look at the code of an application, right, so most, I believe almost all of the call instructions are actually relative offsets. So they say call negative 23 bytes from me and start executing from there. So in that case, it's completely relocatable. It doesn't matter where in memory you put it, and it doesn't have anything to do with the base pointer. So why do we need a global offset table? Static linking, which takes libc and basically puts it all into one binary, or dynamic linking, where at runtime it has to load the libc, the .so file, put that into memory, and then change the offsets to all the pointers. So the global offset table is what allows this to do that, because the global offset table has code that way your program, instead of calling the function printf, which it has no idea where it will be at runtime, it calls some little trampoline function which grabs a value that's in a fixed memory location and jumps to it. And so at runtime, when libc is loaded, those values are changed to point to the actual printf location. Cool. We'll look at this more in a second, because it's actually super important. Because the global offset table entries are at fixed memory locations, they have to be, because it has to be changed, so it is not relocatable. So as long as you're able to overwrite one of those values with, let's say, the address of your shellcode, you can redirect control flow wherever you want. So how are exceptions done in C? Do you need any type of exception handling?
Based on the return value, so.
Yeah, so normally a lot of functions, so like when you call into the kernel or something, it's the return value, right? If it gives you something that's not zero, then that means there was some kind of error. And then you can interrogate some other value to see if there's an error or a mistake. But when you use a language like, I don't know, Java has exceptions pretty well baked into the language. So what's the purpose? Why do you have exceptions in a language like Java? Why not just check return codes?
Yeah, so the calling code may be able to recover from that error, right? Can catch that error, maybe change the environment, try different things, and then maybe make a new call.
So C actually has similar functionality to do this type of behavior. But it does, it's called a long jump, because you're essentially, if you think about the, how an exception works, it doesn't matter how far down the call chain you are, jump back up to wherever that code was that defined that exception handler, which is similar to how it works in other languages. So there's two important functions here, set jump and long jump. So set jump, essentially you can think of kind of captures all the information that's necessary to jump back to that program state. So it actually contains things like the base pointer, the program counter, any variables that are necessary. And then long jump actually jumps back to that point, yeah.
Does it say if it's on the stack?
Depends, but yes. It depends on how it's used. So we can look at a very simple program. So this is a int main program, argc, argv. So it has a jump buff. So this is the data structure called env. And then, so the set jump value is env, and then I believe it's similar to fork, where the return value of set jump tells you if you're returning from an exception handle or not. And so that will fill in this env variable with everything that's needed, and so that way, when you call something like here in this else block, we're printing out the value of I, we're calling some function f1, where f1 takes in a jump buffer and checks if there's some error condition, then it can do a long jump of error 1 to E, otherwise it can pass it to F2, and F2 can then also do an exception handler. So from both of these locations, this long jump can jump back to that set jump in main. And so looking at exactly how the jump buffer is implemented, we can see that, so the jump buffer is an array of 6 integers, which is actually not that big to deal with all this. And let's see, so it has all these values, I think the base pointer and the stack pointer and the PC, so you can see that it's storing exactly on the stack these values of where to jump to when there's an error. And so essentially you can think of this is another place where the control flow of the application depends on values that are stored on the stack. So if we can overwrite those values and we overwrite the PC in exactly the place that we want to, we don't have to necessarily overwrite the saved EIP because maybe we don't have enough of an overwrite there. Maybe we can only write over a little bit. But if we can control and overwrite and change this jump buffer program counter value, then we can overflow that and divert the control flow of the application. This is a snippet from long jump, which takes an environment pointer and the I variable. So we can actually walk through this code since it's very simple. It's moving I into EAX, so it's setting a return value. Remember, the return value is always in the EAX register. It's setting environment, so this is the variable env.jumpbuffer.jbbp, so that's, yeah.
What's the nature of I? Is it a register or is it a...
This is pseudo assembly code, so without going through all of the, yeah. So this is getting this I parameter, so you can think that it's getting whatever. We could write this code, it's EBP minus, no, EBP plus 12, because 8 would be the first parameter, and then 12. Although it's slightly confusing, because ENV, I think, is that data structure, so it's actually longer, so yes. Basically we take that I parameter, which is the second parameter passed to long jump, set that to the EAX register, take environment, dereference it, and access the jump buffer base pointer offset, which I think was 4, and move that into EBP, so now that EBP is set up, set the stack pointer to change the stack pointer, and finally, and you can see that since you can't reference env dot underscore underscore jump buff, you'd have to set all these up in registers first. So basically that's how I would do it. Set them in registers, copy them over. And then you finally jump back to whatever value is stored in the jump buffer at the JD underscore PC offset. So this is where we can see that control flow is diverted based on the value inside this env data structure. So, yeah.
Why we are only saving the six GPL registers instead of saving all of them? Because you know the color, maybe clobber, actually the color maybe clobber the other stuff when it's routing that. So,
that. No, so this is, that's a good question. The short answer is I don't know. So you have to look at it. It probably depends on the environment and what things need to be saved or not saved. Or there may be, maybe your set jump is something you have to do at the very start of your function to be compatible. Otherwise, you may not get the variables you expect. So yeah, it's a good question. So if we can override it, we can then control. So here, we're really going over a high level here, but this is really just an example to show you that wherever control flow can diverge based on data stored onto the stack or into a value that you can control, then you can overwrite values. So basically, the key here is saved PIP is not always your target. So you need to start thinking holistically when you look at an application and you think, there's an overflow here, but it's only 120 bytes and the buffer is only 100 bytes, and that's 120 is not enough to get to the saved PIP, so what things can I do? Look and see if there's anything else on the stack that you could possibly alter, change, corrupt the value of. You can do all kinds of cool stuff. There's a paper, I think it's been 2 years now, maybe 3 years now, Usenix Security, that was called Data-Oriented Exploits. So automatically creating exploits for a binary application that didn't take the control flow, so didn't overwrite EIP, but by changing the data that was on the stack, they could achieve arbitrary computation, which was pretty cool. So. Yeah, this stuff's pretty important. Cool. All right, looking at more things about what we can overwrite. And this is, again, why I tried to harp on a lot about what are the exact semantics of things. So you see a function like gets, or you see a function like string copy, or you see a function like string end copy, right? What exactly does it do? And how do you find out exactly what it does? Yes, read the man page. Awesome, all right. So we can have a program. We can have a character buffer username, character password. This is code that you'll see all the time. String end copy argv1 into password of 512 characters. So what's the idea behind string end copy? Yeah, so only copy 512 bytes. This is good, right? We're using the proper function, right? If we're using string copy, is that vulnerable?
Yes,
absolutely, 100%. That is definitely vulnerable, right? Because we cannot bound the value. But here we can say we are only copying 512 bytes from argv1 into the password field, right? That's good. Then we do string end copy argv2 of 512 into username. Then we print out checking password for user, and we return, we call some function check password. And if we look at check password, so we're passing our password into this function. So we have a function check pwd, character pointer, which has a buffer of my password of 512 bytes, and do a string copy now of p onto the local buffer of my password, perform some checking it, and then return zero. So this looks good, right? So the code here, we're doing string end copy of 512 bytes, right? So do either of these string copies overflow, the string end copies overflow their respective buffers? No, right? They will copy 512 bytes into each of those buffers. But what is the exact semantics of string end copy? Yeah.
Oh, it copies the minimum of 512 or the null point.
Yes. Okay. So we need to look at it because I actually don't know either. Or I mean,
phrase whatever first comes.
Yeah. So let's look at man string and copy. All right. The string copy function, beware of buffer overruns, it's very bad. The string end copy is similar, except that at most n bytes of source are copied. Seems reasonable, right? We want at most 512 bytes. Warning, if there is no null byte among the first n bytes of source, the string placed in destination will not be null terminated. So what does this mean? So if we do, yeah.
It means that if you put in 512 characters that none of them are the null terminator, then it'll...
Right, so you have a buffer of 512 characters, right? And you do a string end copy of 512 A's, which in RB1 would be 512 A's followed by a null byte, 0. And so string end copy, will it copy 513 into your buffer?
No,
it'll copy 512 A's into there. But it specifically says that it's not going to put a null terminating character at the end. So you'll have A, 512 of those, with no null termination.
So why is that a problem here, back to our program? Yeah. So what's the possible size of this character pointer P that we're copying onto my password?
Until a null.
Size of the
so let's think about it this way. What is the size that the developer wanted that to be?
512. But what happens if I copy, assuming that the buffers are in memory as they are in the stack? So there's 512, so essentially character password buffer is 512 characters behind character user name. So what happens if I pass 512 characters as password? Is that a problem?
Yes.
Is it yet?
Null terminated and the rest of the memory can override.
Yeah, so let's say, okay, so let's think about it this way. So I have 512 A's, I do string end copy into password, 512 A's into password. Right? Fills up that buffer.
Right.
It puts no null terminating byte at the end. And then after there I have 20 B's that get put into username. What's now if I calculated the string length of password, what would it be?
532.
Yeah, 532.
Oh,
right?
You said
24. Is it? And whatever. Yes, more. Right?
Because how does string length determine this length of a string? Right? It keeps counting bytes until it gets to a null character. And so it's going to count the 512 A's and see is the next character a null byte. No, it's not. All of those bytes in username are part of the string length of password. So by using this, an attacker can fill the password field with 512 characters of whatever they want, another 512 characters of whatever they want for username, and then when that's copied onto the buffer in my PWD, that can potentially be 1024 bytes, which is definitely enough to then reach the EIP. So this is like crazy. I don't know about you guys, but I think this stuff is super awesome. And the fact that it comes from code that looks on surface level correct, right? Because if you're doing this, you would say, great. Are there any string copies with user input into buffers? No. They're using string end copy. And they're specifically putting the size of exactly what it should be, 512. But because of the way the buffers are aligned, and because of the fact that string end copy does not null terminate a string, we can get the total size of password to be 1024 bytes, which overflows this MyPWD buffer. Any questions on this? Yeah. So this just recaps basically what we talked about. But this is the entire idea here. This is why the semantics of how things work are so incredibly important, and knowing them, and even if you've seen a function before, I do this now, you see a function, just look up the semantics to reread it in your mind. because this actually helps sometimes if you, let's say it's using gets versus using argv1. Gets, let's see, oh, can't have new lines or, yeah, can't have new lines or null characters. Or can have null but not new lines or something. I don't know. You just have to look it up for each possible usage. Okay, so you should always make sure that strings are null terminated, and you should be very defensive about how you're doing this. So how could you change this code without changing the size of the buffers to make this safe? What was that?
Start and copy.
Say it again?
Start and copy instead of start copy. String copy.
Oh, string copy? I don't know what that is. Is that a C function?
Instead of copying the whole thing, we can limit it to 512 bytes again.
Yeah, that's what they're doing. They're limiting it to 512 bytes, right? Yeah.
You say not to change the buffer size?
Yeah.
Okay.
So to null, right? You can set the last one to null.
Right, so exactly. So what you should do, if you know the buffer should be 512 bytes at most, you should set the bracket 511 to be null after every operation, right? And that would definitely prevent this, because even, so you're never, string and copy will never overwrite that buffer. Or other ways to fix this is you could do string and copy of 511, so do 512 minus 1, and then make sure you set that last byte. Or you could zero out the entire buffer first, but it's always good to be very defensive and say, you know, you need to understand the way strings operate, and if you want to make sure you have a null terminated string, you should make sure you have a null terminated string.
Which one is better, zeroing it out first or just setting the last one?
I would say setting the last one because I think it's better to be explicit. That's kind of more of an implicit check, because if somebody, let's say, changed it from 511 in that case to 512 because they're like, why aren't we using up all of our buffers, and your protection is basically eliminated. But doing it after the string end copy, you're making an explicit declaration in the code, I want the string to only have this length. Cool. Awesome. Okay. All right. So other types of overflows. So we've looked at basically things like string copy, which basically just concurrently or consecutively overwrite memory onto a stack. Pretty sure we did this, but so we know that there's no boundary checks, right? Which is clearly the problem here. All right, so to prove that I did talk about this before, you can tell me the answer. So we have a character pointer A, we have an int I. So if I say AI is equal to 20, what does that actually mean?
20 ith position from A.
Yeah, so take A, which is some character pointer, do pointer arithmetic so that it's I length away from A. So in this case, it's character pointer, so it's a byte operation, and then dereference that, right? I'm pretty sure we talked about this, where this is the reason why you can write I bracket A, because it's just purely pointer arithmetic. So this means if an attacker can control this value of I, can they put negative numbers in there? Sure, why not? Will the CPU gladly add a positive number to a negative number?
Yes.
Yes, absolutely. And the compiler or the CPU will also gladly dereference. So the idea is we may not be able to get an arbitrary complete, let's say, buffer overflow, but if we can control the index variable, we now have a fixed offset of the buffer that we can maybe write into, depending on the vulnerability. So here's an example. So we have an int main, argc, argv. We have an array of size 8 of int. On the stack, we have an int index, an int value. We then set index to be string 2l. So this is a libc function that converts a string into its long representation, which I think we'll do up to, is it 64 or 32 actually? I actually don't know, that's not that important for here, so it's fine. So convert that in base 10, so whatever value you put in there, then convert value to base 16 in argv2, and then set array bracket index to be value, and then return 0. So what's the problem here? Yeah, we fundamentally have a 32-bit write, arbitrary write, wherever we want in an offset from buffer. So we could. So what would be possible targets?
EIP.
Yeah, EIP. So we actually know exactly the array. We know that array is at EIP, let's say, minus 8 in this example. It could be minus 12, it could be whatever. But we know it's down, located down the stack. So this means if we overwrote, let's see, array plus 8, what would we overwrite? Stack diagram. So let's say it's at minus 8. If we did array plus 8 and overwrote that, what would be there? EBP. So we could maybe control the base pointer. And then if we did array plus 12, we could overflow EIP, exactly. So so using this, we can play with this, and you can overwrite, you know, arbitrary values here. And so so this is an example where you don't have a consecutive buffer overflow, but we can still control EIP here. So where should I put my shell code?
In the EIP.
What?
As an argument to this.
Yeah, so all that has to happen is my shellcode needs to be somewhere that is executable memory. And we know that the stack is executable in the examples we're looking at. And we know that all of the argv parameters are on the stack, data on the stack. And it's using argv1 and argv2, but it doesn't do any argc checks to see is that the only argument variable. So we can put it in argv3. We could put it in the environment, because the environment is passed to the program, right? We can do any of these things to pass our shellcode. So even though we're not writing it onto the stack, this is another important concept, right? In a lot of the buffer overflows we look at, is you have your shell, so you have a NOP sled, you have your shellcode, you have the address you want to overwrite, and you jump somewhere in there. But that doesn't have to be the case. Your shellcode can basically be anywhere. All right, so you should check. I mean, this is the entire problem, right, with using C, is that there's no bounds checking. So you, as a programmer, when you're developing your applications, you need to be very careful about making sure that you're checking the bounds in everything. All right, cool. Okay, so loop overflows are another case where we can control, or the attacker's input controls the number of loops that we execute. And so, in a special case, so has anybody ever written a loop that had an off by one problem?
Long time ago.
I would guess you probably haven't been looking too closely at your code then. Well, I think there's a couple variations of this joke. But have you heard this joke where there's two things that are really difficult in programming? It's caching, naming things, and off by one errors. And so, yes. Thank you. I'll be here twice a week. So, similar things can happen when, so it's very easy when you're writing a loop, like a for loop, instead of doing a less than equal to. And so the loop can maybe execute more times than you were expecting. So this happens a lot in off by one, so let's look at, yes, this is a really good example. Okay, so we have a function called func that takes in a character pointer sm. We have a buffer that's length 256. We have an int I. We then have a loop for I is equal to 0, I less than or equal to 256, I plus plus. Buffer I equals smi. And that's it. So we have int main if argc is less than 2. So just check that we have 2 argument parameters and call func with argv1. So what's the problem here? Yeah, the problem is we're overwriting in our loop, right? How many times does loop execute? Yeah, how many times did the developer want the loop to execute at most? 256, because that's the size of this buffer. But the problem is the way it's written, it actually can execute up to 257 times. So let's draw a stack, because this example is very cool. So, all right. So let's look at, we have our nice off by one, our code. So we have our buffer func. And this actually comes up a lot in more advanced exploitation techniques, which is why I want to spend some time on it. So thinking about this, so let's say, so so why is it important that this loop executes 257 times instead of 256? What does it actually allow us to do? But how much of the program's memory can we actually corrupt?
One byte.
One single byte. Right? We can only control one byte of the program. So let's draw this. So we have func. So we know func is. So we know we're going to draw our nice stack. We know that the EBP is going to point here, and right where EBP points, we know we have saved EBP, which we actually know is the EBP of main, which is going to be some value located higher up on the stack. What do we have above saved EBP? Yeah, saved EIP. And then what's at EBP minus 256? Yeah, buff, right? And we'd actually need to verify this with the binary code. So we wouldn't want to just look at the C code and draw the stack, because the C code is an illusion, right? The C code is what the programmer wants. The compiler actually makes the stack layout. So it could be, you know, it could put int I above that, in which case we only can change one byte of I, which may or may not give us what we want. But let's say for argument's sake that buffer's here, and we know that the distance here is 256. So by overwriting this, right, we do byte, all the way up. So in this diagram, what do we control? We can control the least significant byte of EBP. Or,
is it most?
Say it again.
Why isn't it the most? Because isn't it going, if you're saving reverse?
Yeah, so it's going up. So we're going up. So we will overflow EBP plus one. And the way the byte layout is EBP plus one is the most significant byte of the saved EBP.
Okay.
Yeah, it's because of the endianness. If this is a big endian, then we would be controlling the most significant byte. But because it's little endian, it's flipped around, we're controlling the least significant byte. Mm-hmm. So can we control, so how many bytes are on this saved EBP? Four bytes. We only control 3. How do we actually leverage this into execution? Because it's crazy. We only get 1 byte of data, of memory that we're changing.
But it's 256 actual byte values that we actually have access to, which is actually a fairly large window, right? So of that, you maybe identify where in main you could actually change things. Right.
Yeah, but how does that work? Okay, so let's actually extend this stack up a little bit. I don't want this. Okay, getting rid of all this since we know this. So what's above say VIP? Which one? So this is all, we know this is all func, right? F-U-N-C. So what's above the say VIP?
Stack frame of main.
Yeah, so the stack frame of main. So what does main stack frame look like? Yeah, so we need the char SM. So we need character pointer SM. And then what's above that?
what it pushed on the stack. Did it push anything? No.
So save EBP, whatever when main was called, the save main's save EBP. So we actually know that right here is main's EBP. So we actually know that this save EBP points into here. And what's above the save EBP in main's function frame? Right, save VIP, exactly what we like. And we actually know above that is int argc. Above that, right, we know more and more about, we know that character pointer argv, and we know above that is the actual argv data. Cool. So how does changing the save EBP help us? Can only change one byte, the least significant byte. So let's think about this. So what happens when func returns? We do the function prolog, just like always, right? We set the stack pointer, the current base pointer, and then we pop EBP. That's the leave instruction. So the base pointer will then point to whatever is in here, which is main's EBP. And then it does return, so it jumps to the saved EIP. So can we change the saved EIP? No. Fundamentally, we can't change that saved EIP. We can only change the least significant byte of the saved EBP. But then after func returns, what happens in the program? It does return zero, so main's going to return. So now the base pointer's here. So now what happens? Yeah, so now main's going to return. So the same thing happens. So main does a leave, which sets the stack pointer to main's EBP, does a pop EBP, which pops this save EBP off the stack, so that'll point somewhere higher up. And then it does a return to jump to this save EIP. So how did it know? How did it get to this saved EIP on the stack in main? So not main's EIP, but the function that called main. How did it get there? Because of main's base pointer. Because wherever main's base pointer points to, when main hits its epilogue, it's going to basically essentially jump to whatever's at 4 plus that. So, if you could control main's base pointer, where would you want to put it? What was that?
In the buffer.
In the buffer. Where in the buffer?
Anywhere between.
Yeah, so what if, let's ignore the one byte problem for now. Let's say we could just completely change this save BBP. So we want to put it in the buffer. Is there a special place you want it? What was that?
Right below,
maybe here. So let's say we're able to change it here. What do we want to be at that location? Gel code? It's our buffer. What do we want?
Some address that points to the shell code.
So the address of the shell code? We'll say we'll start our shellcode off at buffer, right? So we overwrite, let's say we completely control this save EBP to point to here. So then func returns, so it's gonna set main's EBP to not point to here, but instead main EBP. Then main does its function epilogue, which does a leave, which sets the stack pointer equal to the EBP, so the stack pointer is going to point down here. It's going to do a pop EBP, so it's going to put the address of shellcode in EBP, and then it's going to return. So what's actually 4 above shellcode? Yeah, you just caused the program to crash because it's going to go to garbage. So you actually want it is to point to, well, you need your address of shellcode. And then 4 below that, you just need some junk. And if you set the address of, if you change save DBP to point here, now when main returns, it will do a leave, set the stack pointer equal to main EBP. It's gonna be here, pop EBP, which is gonna move the stack up one, and then do a return, so it will return to the address of your shellcode. So, but can we control all of the save base pointer on the stack?
Can you go through that again?
Yes.
Set address of shellcode and then what?
So, what we need is we need whatever we change the save EBP to, we want 4 bytes above that to be the address of our shellcode, because 4 bytes above that is where it will return when it does a ret. Because the function epilogue of main will be a leave and then a return. But the question is, how do we actually do that? Because in our previous example, we controlled all 4 bytes of save EBP, but we actually only control 1 byte, the least significant byte. How can we do this? Yeah?
Because you are controlling the least significant byte, which is actually happening in the end, is the most significant byte. So you are controlling over a high range of the addresses.
No, it's the other way. It's specifically the least significant byte. So it's the highest. It's definitely not. EBP plus one will allow us to control the least significant byte. I mean, for that I'm sure, because I've done this very recently. So it'll do the least significant byte. Let's just leave that for now. Yeah. So what do we put that value to be? Because we have 256 values we can put in there. Should we put FF in there? Why is that a bad idea?
I don't know what it is. I would look and see what window you have available with that.
Why do we need a window available?
Because you have 256 bytes that you need to know which of those of that area can manipulate, right? If that window is like in some part that you can't change, then you can't take advantage of it.
Yeah, so we can play a little bit of games. We know that we can actually change the stack pointer, or we can move the stack down by changing the environment or adding more RG variables. So we can actually control it, and we can use GDB to control it. But even just thinking about it, right, odds are this value is somewhere between 0 and FF. If we change it all to FF, will that get us to our buffer? So we only have 256 cases to think about in your head.
At least we need
So we need this pointing into our buffer. If we change this to all Fs, will that work?
It's going
to
have a lot less than it was before, and FF can never be less than whatever it was.
Exactly. So fundamentally, if we think about it as FF, so there's only either that last byte was FF, in which case we don't move the pointer at all. The other options are values less than FF, but that will actually just increase the pointer. So the pointer main EBP, by changing this to FF, we can only go up the stack, which is not what we want, because it's actually could be what we want if we can get it to point into one of the argv parameters we control, but likely we can't get there. So by the other logic, what about 0, 0? Or just 0? Yeah, it'll be a negative offset based on however far up main EBP is. So it's likely all we need to be is 4, 8, 12, another 4, 16. All we need is negative 16. So even just putting 0, 0, we have can't do the math. There's 256 minus 16 over 256 chances of actually being inside of our own buffer where we want. And then We can put address of shellcode. So we put junk here underneath address of shellcode. We can actually just spam address of shellcode everywhere, right? So as long as EBP points somewhere in there, then we'll go to the address of our shellcode here. And so basically, what was our shellcode? Like 32 bytes or something? So we have 32 bytes of our shellcode, then we just fill it up with the address of shellcode, then we put the last byte to zero, and then that will hopefully, whatever, only 16 times will that fail. And then if that does fail, we can change our stack layout to try to get that to work. Does that make sense? But the key, the really important thing is, so basically, and it's also called, the other technique and way to think about this, it's called pivoting the stack. So we're changing, essentially we're like shifting the stack, but instead of actually going up and down through function calls, we're shifting the stack down into our buffer, so it thinks, we're basically faking it to thinking that main's function frame is inside of our buffer, which means if we can fake it to think that main's function frame is inside of our buffer, we control that buffer, so we can make a fake function frame with the return address of wherever we want. Where this gets tricky is, let's say, what if main did some other stuff after func? What if it had local variables that it set, or other parameters? Or what if it accesses argv1 or argv2 or argc?
Sorry, silly question before that. Where would the shellcode be?
For this, we could put it actually here in our buffer.
Be in there.
Yeah. As long as we know the address of the shellcode and we fill up the rest of the buffer with that. So what happens if after func in main there was check argv2?
I won't be able to find it.
Why not?
Because it doesn't have a base pointer. You're right.
Does it have a base pointer?
It doesn't have the right base pointer.
Ah, so it has a base pointer, right? So remember, when we control save EBP, we're going to change main's base pointer to be somewhere in here, inside our buffer. Which means that after that point in the function that called us in main, any references to EBP will be our EBP. So if we do any of these kind of things or dereference things, this can cause the whole thing to crash.
So you may actually have to very delicately construct your stack frame to make sure that everything actually works.
But you can actually, you know, as long as the values don't have to be certain things, you can just put any addressable memory in there and that would hopefully work. So. It all kind of depends on what goes on, but anyways, this is just trying to hint at the actual problems that can come up here. But so fundamentally, though, if you can control a single byte of the EBP, you can often turn that into complete arbitrary code execution, which is insane. And this still happens. So there's actually a, is it XM? There's a recent thing where it was a heap overflow, it was an off by one heap overflow in the base64 decoding of a mail server. I think it was XM. Is that what it was? Yeah, that's what I thought. So it was base64 decoding in the XM mail server, and it overwrote one more byte than it allocated. And so they actually developed a whole unauthenticated remote code execution through this by carefully constructing values on the heap and freeing them in the correct order just by using this off by one. So it's the same type of ideas and principles and techniques that apply there. But obviously the byte that you're overwriting is different, so you have to be careful about that. But anyways, this is one of the coolest things. I like love this stuff. All right, so we talked about that. Yeah, this is all just, I'm gonna skip over these diagrams. You can use this at your leisure to but this is really just exactly what we went over. Cool. Save it. Tracking it. Exploiting off by one. There we go. See, look at this. You guys did all this. All right. What were we doing here? Okay. So we should probably go over this, I guess. Cool. Okay, so
No, okay, this is fine. All right, this is all just stuff about how to get this and calculate it. Anyway, you need to be very precise. But we basically already did this. Okay, so so for loop overflows, so if a user can control the amount of times a loop executes, that is a huge problem. Even if a user can't, but for whatever reason that loop allows them to overwrite into arbitrary memory, that can also be a huge problem. And oftentimes, OppFi1 vulnerabilities are really tricky because they may not crash your program. Like, you may not test the input necessarily with however many bytes or the exact byte that actually crashes the program. So it's definitely bad. Okay, cool. Format string. So this is the other cool thing. So basically, in all the things we've seen so far, so in buffer overflows, you have continuous memory that you're overwriting. In an array index, you control a relative offset. But a lot of these, especially like, let's say a buffer overflow, it's kind of like a hammer. Like, has anyone ever destroyed something with like a sledgehammer? Like, anyone done like kitchen renovations or something? It's like one of the funnest things you can ever do. If anybody ever invites you to think like, oh, I'm getting rid or I'm redoing my kitchen, ask to be involved in the demo, because there's something awesome about taking a huge hammer to like a cabinet while wearing safety glasses so don't get hurt. But it's super awesome. So I think of buffer overflow like that. Like, you're just, you can make a huge knock sled, you just throw addresses in there, you start overwriting, you can overwrite megabytes of memory or whatever. You just don't care. You're just taking a sledgehammer and just breaking down the door, destroying all kinds of memory. The difference between that and, let's say, like a cool spy movie, when the spy gets there and then they have that like little gadget they put on the glass that like carefully cuts the glass without triggering the alarms, and then they use that to like go inside, right? That's more like a format string. So a format string, we'll see, you actually can arbitrarily write bytes into memory of bytes that you control and you decide what they are. So it's like that, it's like a scalpel. Like, you make a tiny incision to the program and you can completely, again, control the execution of the program. So, what is a format string? How does printf work?
When it comes passes the string and when it comes across percentage.
So let's look at printf and three. All right, printf. So the function definition of printf. It's, again, we know it's a libc function. It returns an integer. How many variables or how many parameters does printf take in? At least one, because it takes in the format string, right? So, and this isn't just, you know, it has a very specific format, that's why it's called the format string. And the dot 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 in the printf means that it takes an arbitrary number of parameters. How does printf know how many parameters it takes? Yeah, so you can think of actually the format string language as a domain-specific language for printing things. And so every time printf gets to a value, so think about every percent d that it sees while it's parsing that string, it knows that the first percent d is the first argument, the second percent d is the second argument. And so how does printf know how to find those values?
And sees on the stack.
Say it again?
It goes and sees on the stack because arguments are pushed on the stack for
it. Yeah, so it knows the first argument, the character, the format string is EBP plus 8, and it knows that the next one after that is at EBP plus 12, and then depending on that size, it'll be EBP plus 16, well, I almost said 18, and so on and so forth, right? So up the stack, and it just can keep looking up the stack, and so this is actually one of the reasons we talked about why does cdecl do push things onto the stack in right to left order. It's so you can have functions that take a variable number of arguments, because you
you know how to access any n argument, right? Is you just, and you know how to access the first one since it's a fixed location. So the first argument can tell you how to access the rest of them and how many there are. Whereas if you had it the other way, if the first argument was the first one pushed on, you'd need to know the exact number of arguments in order to fetch that last
one.
So
the first it is
bytes. So the printf, the first argument to printf is a character pointer. So a character pointer is the size of memory, so it'd be 4 bytes.
Okay. And that's how we would know how many follow?
Yes. So by not by the size, but by parsing the format strings. So that's what we're going to talk about in a second. So format strings, if you look at it, is anybody, so probably not, and you've hopefully never maybe thought about reading the man page for printf. There's actually a lot of joyful functionality in here. So with printf, not only can you print out, let's say, an integer in a value that you can understand, you can prefix values with zeros, you can, oh man, there's so much stuff here. You can, let's see, a character, see, and there's even flags that you can set, you probably did not know that. You can set a percent followed by zero or more flags. Zero means it's zero padded. Dash means it's left, it's adjusted, either left justification or right justification. Assigned conversion. Let's see, I'm just reading through these things because I don't remember all these things. Some of them are actually important, as we'll talk about. But let's see, precision, length modifier. So you can, if you've ever wondered how you write out maybe a character in terms of a characters, so you can do signed character, short int, long int, LL, a long int, so on and so forth. D and I are what we normally think of as decimal notation. X is actually, reading through this, I found the P value, which was actually very nice to print out pointers. Doubles, okay, so okay, P, yeah, P is a void star, so it prints it out as with percent X, like 0x, so it's nicer to see. And as we know, based on a lot of things, because the percent is now the special encoding character in this special language, we use percent to output 1% character. So let's say you're writing an old school application and you're trying to make sure that, let's say your output is, I don't know, lined up correctly in terms of tables. So you output something, and then you output the user's input, and then you need to know how many like dots to put to make sure that it's like nicely aligned with everything. So how do you know how many characters a printf string outputs?
Percentage n.
What?
Percentage n.
Percentage n.
Yeah, does anybody actually know that or ever use that? Percent n in a printf? So the n here, so it looks very benign. So it says the number of characters written so far is stored into the integer pointed to by the corresponding argument. That number, that argument shall be an int star, which makes sense because you're writing to it, so it has to be a memory address that you're passing in, or variant whose size matches the optionally supplied integer length modifier. No argument is converted. The behavior is undefined if the conversion specification includes any flags, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so why is that important? So let's look. So so a couple things. So how does printf, we just talked about it, just to reiterate, how does printf know how many parameters it's passed?
Format string.
Based on the format string, right? So every percent D or percent whatever will be an argument on the stack.
And so whose responsibility is it to make sure that the number of arguments passes matches the format string? The developers, right? The person writing the application. So think about this. Similarly, it's kind of similar in terms of buffer overflows. So a string cat from a user input string that's unbounded to something that is bounded like a buffer will always cause a buffer overflow because an attacker can control that string. So if we have a format string What if the attacker can control the string that is passed into printf?
The format string.
The format string, the first argument.
Yeah.
Let's say, has anyone been lazy and done that before, where you do, instead of printf %s some username, you just do printf username? It happens. It's okay.
You can admit it. So what if an attacker could do that and could control that string, that format string? What could they do?
Pass it format string.
So they could pass in a format string, so what?
If they pass percentage D, might look on the stack.
Yeah, so for every percent D or percent whatever that they pass in, right, printf does not know how many parameters are passed into printf.
All printf knows is that I'm supposed to parse this format string. And for every percent D, I look up a stack, an argument on the stack, and I keep looking up. Does printf know how many parameters are passed in? No, I just said that. Does printf care how many parameters are passed in? No. Again, just like a buffer overflow, right? The CPU doesn't care. Printf doesn't care. All it knows is, OK, for every percent D that I see, I look up from the frame pointer on the stack, and I keep
printing out values. So, what this means is that, A, I think it's one of the things that should be clear right off the bat is clearly somebody could just print out your whole stack, right? They could pass in a bunch of percent D, percent D, percent D, percent D, and print that out, and steal information on your stack. So if you have passwords stored in memory, they could steal those passwords, all kinds of bad stuff. So if you have information leakage vulnerabilities, this actually, sometimes you'll have some vulnerabilities where you use a printf vulnerability or a format string. Maybe you can't get arbitrary code execution, but you leak a pointer, which you then use to defeat ASLR and other types of vulnerabilities. So if you say, you know, hello, percent %s name, here, in this example, can an adversary control the format string that's passed to printf? No, so it does not matter. They can completely control whatever they want for the name. There's no possible way that this code is vulnerable, right? Because the format string itself is constant. But if we do printf buff and the attacker can control buff, is fundamentally 100% insecure and a vulnerability because an attacker can completely control the contents of buff. So we can set buff to be %d space %d and then it will start printing elements off the stack. We can set it to however many we want. So some cool things about printf, stolen from the man page. So how do you reference a specific argument? Like how do you say I want to print out argument 1 and not just %d, %d, %d? Like how do you say I want to print out argument 3?
I know how to do it in awk.
I have no idea if that's the same. No, I'm just going to say no, it's not.
Oh.
But maybe. Actually, maybe it is.
It's,
is it dollar sign?
It's dollar three.
Yeah.
And then the last field is dollar enough.
Interesting. Okay. So yeah, so the you can't do the last one because it doesn't know which one the last one is.
Okay.
But you can actually use percent %i, where I is some value, and then dollar sign $p. So this will look up the ith element, the ith argument, using that notation. And it doesn't cause an argument to be popped, so you're not actually moving. So when you use percent %d, you can think you're popping values or looking. You think of it as just printf has a pointer, it's moving up the stack. When you do this, it does a calculation to figure out exactly which argument you want and returns that without actually moving up the stack.
Is that why printf is such a big
yes.
bytes function?
Yes, this is why printf is a huge function.
Because you never want to use this in like an embedded system.
Yes, printf is, this is one of those things where you add features over time, like you think like, oh, you add this, and then, oh, wouldn't it be nice to do positional arguments, and then wouldn't it be nice to do percent %ends, so you can know how many characters you have, and then you have this big ball of mud that nobody really knows how it's done, which you can use to completely own programs. And so the other thing, so we can use this to reference arbitrary elements off the stack. So we can actually already use this to leak fixed elements off the stack, which is cool. We can also, so if we have a percent %n that writes out how many characters have been written, if we want to use that to our advantage to write out arbitrary values, what do we need to control?
Address where we need to write it.
We need to, well, maybe an address, but would we want to be able to control the value that we write out? We can use a big string, yeah. When you start talking about addresses, though, like that start with like BFFFFF or FFFFFF, right? Those are pretty big strings. But fundamentally, we want to control that value. And we can use the padding notation. So we can use percent %k and p or some other x value, which says left pad with this many spaces, I believe. So total output, we could say 10,000 characters, and in that little part of our format string, we'll then increment the number of characters output by 10,000. And the other thing we can use is percent %n. So this will, wherever the next element of the stack is, will output, write the number of characters that have been written so far to that output, to that address that's at that location on the stack of that argument. Okay, so for instance, we have hello percent %n. So this, if we wrote this code, so is this code vulnerable? Who controls the format string? It's a constant. The developer controls it, right? So fundamentally, this is not vulnerable. It's doing exactly what it's supposed to be doing. The developer, assuming len is a integer, we're passing in the address of len to get that. So we can look at a super simple vulnerable program. So this is an int main. We have a file pointer f. We do f is equal to fopen/temp log. For appending, we call add log. We call f close. We return 0. Then in add log, we have a character buffer of 65,000 characters. Int I equals 0, result, while 1, read in from into the address of line I, 1 character. If result is equal to 0, so read will return 0 when we either hit end of file or there's an error, I believe. Increment I, if I is equal to 65536, exit. If the line is equal to new line, then basically exit this, read line, and break. Otherwise, fprintf, f to line, and then return 0. So it's a pretty convoluted function, but if you look at this, you should be able to convince yourself that there's no overflow here. Right? This custom loop, even though it's reading characters byte by byte, is actually doing it correctly and is not going to output any malicious characters. But we need to pass some standard input here. So if we pass this standard input, and we can see that every one of our input is going to be passed to fprintf. Every part of our input is going to be passed to fprintf. And so we can say something like, what about 4a's, 4b's, 4c's, 4d's, and then 8% p's. So what are these 8% p's? So it's everything that starts with OX in the output. So first of all, where is this AAA, BBB, CCC, DDD? What is that in this output? That's the constant part of our string. That's the first 16 bytes of our format string. So what about everything else? What's all that?
ABBCCDD. Hexadecimal.
Yeah, it says hex one. Hex 41, 41, 41, 41. Hex 42, 42, 42, 42. Although if we think about it, so this is a call to fprintf. Fprintf is called by the add log function. So when fprintf is reading values from the stack, where does it start from?
pointer where it takes the arguments and stores.
So let's draw the stack. Stack, stack, stack. Cool. All right. So let's look at add log. So add log, we know, has a, this is ugly. All right, has a parameter of a file pointer, F, and then below that will be saved EIP. Below that will be saved EDP. And then will be the huge line. And then I. And then we're going to call fprintf. So after this will be line. F.
This is the add log for you.
This is add log, yeah. This is add log, and then this is going to be printf. F, and then we know this is save EIP, save VBP. So in terms of fprintf, so fprintf has save EBP here, save EIP here, it has, its EBP is here. Where does it think, so how does it know where f is? No, this is the wrong point. It should be save EBP is here. So where does it know where the f parameter is, the file pointer? The first argument, so it's at what? EBP. +8, always at EBP +8. So that's where it's gonna read. It's gonna read bytes from there, and it knows line. So, or sorry, it's gonna print out to F, so it's gonna figure out how to do that. Then with line, it's at EBP +12. It's 4 bytes above that. It knows it's a second parameter. So then when it starts, when it gets to the first of this execution, so it prints out AAA, BBB, CCC, DDD. And then it prints out the first percent %p. What does it think the first argument of the parameters are? Yeah, EBP plus, well, we did 8 was here, 12 is line. So it's at EBP plus 16, right? So that's the first percent %p, and then printf increments up, and then it's percent %p, percent %p, percent %p. So we can actually see that this first percent %0x1, that is the I parameter in our loop. Then we can see we're printing 4141, which is what in hex or ASCII? A, or capital A, 442s, 443s, 444s. And then what's this? The 7025, 7025.
Percentage P, maybe.
Percentage P, yeah. 25 is definitely percent. And P must be lowercase, 70 must be lowercase p. So what we're doing is we're essentially printing our, we've gone into our format string. So we'll pick this up on Wednesday, but you can see that we can control these 4 bytes that we're printing from as 41. So if we put an address here instead of these 4 A's, we can print out what's the content of that memory location. Or, well, anyways, we'll get there. Getting ahead of myself.